It is now time for a question period. The member from Nipissing.
Thank you, and good morning, Speaker. Good morning, Premier. My question is for the Premier. We heard loud and clear during our finance tour and pre-budget hearings, high taxes, skyrocketing energy rates, and red tape. But more than anything, Premier, there is absolutely no support for your provincial gas tax increase. Premier, in the last 10 years, you've doubled our debt, tripled our hydro rates, and now you want to dig deeper into the pockets of hardworking Ontarians. Why is it that to solve the problems you've created, your default is always to increase taxes? Health tax, diamond tax, all sorts of new taxes. And when you spend the money on rich subsidies for wind power, Orange, and cancelling gas plants, people understand. Will you support my opposition motion today and commit to not raising taxes on students, families, and seniors?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I guess I would just respond to the member opposite by saying, why is it that his party is not interested in long-term thinking, Mr. Speaker? Why is it that his party is not interested in making investments in the people and in the infrastructure and in the business climate that we know is going to be necessary in order for this province to thrive, Mr. Speaker? That really is the question that I think has to be answered at this moment, Mr. Speaker. Our plan is to invest in infrastructure. And yes, Mr. Speaker, that includes transit, but it also includes roads and bridges and water systems across the province. I don't know if the member opposite had an opportunity to go to Roma OGRA, Mr. Speaker, but there's not a municipality in this province that isn't interested in stable, predictable infrastructure funding. There's no plan coming from the other side on how they would do that. We have that plan, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Speaker. Premier, your tax and spend government is killing businesses and hurting families. Speaking of Ogaroma, let me share with you some of what we heard. The mayor of North Bay described your gas tax plan this way, quote, "It's an awesome program if the idea is to drive manufacturers and companies out of the province." The mayor of East Ferris wrote to you last month and called your gas tax, quote, "another assault on rural municipalities." The Trillium Auto Dealers warned, quote, "hiking taxes on drivers and vehicles will increase the cost of using public transit." Premier, we've heard loud and clear, high taxes, skyrocketing energy rates, and red tape. Will you support our motion
Order.
Today and not increase taxes?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, and it's, I've had the opportunity to see the mayor of North Bay within the last few weeks, and I saw the mayor of East Ferris yesterday, Mr. Speaker. And I know, Mr. Speaker, that they are very committed to having the right infrastructure built in their communities, Mr. Speaker. And that's why I put the question to the member opposite. How can he not support stable, predictable funding for infrastructure, Mr. Speaker? How can he not support $100 million a year in roads and bridges and water system funding, Mr. Speaker, that municipalities across the province
Answer.
Can count on? That's the kind of investment that I know municipalities across Ontario need, Mr. Speaker. That's why it's part of our plan.
Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker. Premier, you're bringing in nearly $50 billion more in revenue since the time you first took power. And now you want to add 10 cents a litre hike in gas. Here's what Bill Love had to say at our pre-budget consultations. Quote, "It's not a revenue problem, it's really a spending problem." And I think he said it best. Now, you're also planning to raise corporate taxes by 0.5%. Listen to what the Ontario Chamber's Liam McGuinty had to say, and yes, I think you know who that is. The quote, "The bulk of studies show that lowering corporate income taxes has a significant impact on investment." Premier, you don't need that extra money, but what we do need is real leadership here. I'll ask you once more, will you support our motion today that promises no new gasoline, no new corporate, or no new payroll taxes?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you, Premier.
Thank you.
very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, and I just say to the member opposite that I think it would be a very good opportunity, given that this is his line of questioning, for him to talk to the municipal leaders from across the province and tell them that he actually doesn't believe in investing in infrastructure, Mr. Speaker.
Yeah.
He doesn't think there needs to be an investment in their roads and bridges and in transit, Mr. Speaker. I think that would be important. I think he could go on to say that, furthermore, he believes that cutting education workers and cutting health care workers, Mr. Speaker, cancelling full-day kindergarten, cutting tuition supports, that's what their plan is, Mr. Speaker. Well, we think the reverse of that is what is needed. We believe that investment in people, Mr. Speaker, making sure that they have the education supports that they need, making sure that municipalities have the infrastructure that they need, and that we would partner with them on that, Mr. Speaker. We believe that those are the kind of investments that are needed right now.
Thank you. New question. The member from Nepean Carleton.
Thank you very much, Speaker. My question as well is to the Premier. I can think of a billion reasons why Ontarians should be wary of your government's new gas tax for Toronto Transit. It's like a billion popping red flags. The people of this province have seen time and time again that this tired, old Liberal government can't manage their money. They are tired of giving more to the provincial treasury. And that's because this government consistently finds ways to squander their hard-earned tax dollars at a rate of about $1 billion at a time. The orange scandal, the gas plant scandal, the e-health scandal, the Hydro One scandal, miscalculation of the hydro debt retirement charge are billion-dollar babies of Premier Mom and her predecessor,
question.
Premier Dad. Why is the Premier—
Stop the clock, please. I'm going to ask the member to address the Premier properly, as we do for everyone in this place. No first names, no personal names, titles only. Please finish. You have 10.
Why is the Premier asking Ontarians for more money when she can't manage the money that they send to Queen's Park now?
Thank you. Seat her, please. Seat her, please. Thank you, Premier.
Mr. Speaker. So let's just. Oh, sorry.
Again, and if I hear it again, I'll ask the person to withdraw or leave. It's enough. We're respectful in this place. Carry on.
Mr. Speaker, I have been called worse things than a mom. Mr. Speaker, it is extremely important to me that, in answer to both the questions from the opposition and, in fact, from the questions from the third party, that it is clear that we have said that we are going to invest in transit. That is true. We're going to invest in infrastructure, Mr. Speaker. There have been a number of reports and a number of suggestions about how we might do that. We will bring a plan forward in our budget, Mr. Speaker. And I know that it's in the interest of the opposition to focus on one particular revenue tool and to ride that one. We have not made a decision, Mr. Speaker, on how we will put together that plan. That is the work that we are doing right now. But what I will say, Mr. Speaker, is we know very clearly that avoiding investment in infrastructure, as the opposition did in the past and would do again, is irresponsible, is not in the best interest of this province, either now or in the future.
Speaker, I have to laugh at her. Just last week, we had a sinkhole in Waller Street in Ottawa. That's the infrastructure of the province of Ontario. It's crumbling after a decade of decline. The Premier should admit that she does not have a plan. She just wants the money. Her claim for the people of Ottawa and London and Windsor and Sudbury to wait until her budget to tell them how much money they are going to have to send to Toronto for Toronto taxes is a stall tactic. This government is desperate for cash, and she doesn't care where it comes from. She just wants it to spend their money. They've had an inability to manage the economy, whether it's in the energy sector, whether it's jobs, the economy, or right now with the transit plan here in the GTA. This is the great province of Ontario. She has squandered the opportunity. Will the Premier admit she won't tell us what she's going to do with that transit tax because she doesn't know?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. This is exactly the kind of rhetoric, Mr. Speaker, that has made it so impossible for governments to take action on important long-term issues for decades, Mr. Speaker. The fact is, we have been investing in transit since we came into office. We've been investing in infrastructure, and we exponentially have increased the number of dollars that we've put into infrastructure compared to what their government did, Mr. Speaker. But the fact is, we are going to continue to make those investments. We are having an honest conversation with people across the province about the needs for infrastructure. That's why the $100 million infrastructure fund for roads and bridges for northern and rural communities, that's why that fund is in place, Mr. Speaker, because those communities said to us that they need predictable infrastructure funding. We need partnerships, municipal, federal, provincial, working together. That's the process we're working on, Mr. Speaker.
Premier, this Premier has had a decade to put forward a plan and to spend money wisely. She had an opportunity this past year to invest in the 401, but people were losing tires on the side of the road. She had an opportunity to deal with the sinkholes in Ottawa, but they're still happening. She had an opportunity to build subways in Toronto. She didn't do it. She wants the people's money, and she wants billions of it from all across this province for just downtown Toronto, but she doesn't know what she's going to use it for. And the other problem this Premier has is she is losing jobs, she is hiking energy rates, and she has no plan. She wants to cling to power. She has an opportunity this afternoon. She can support our motion. Will she do it? Yes or no?
Thank you. Premier.
Speaker, I'm sorry, but the rant is just ridiculous. $500 million for the Queensway Carleton Hospital in the member's riding, Mr. Speaker. The Southern and the Northern Highway programs, Mr. Speaker. It is just ridiculous to suggest that this government has not invested in infrastructure. We have done it year over year. We are going to continue to do it, Mr. Speaker. And the reality is that there was an infrastructure deficit when we came into office, Mr. Speaker, in 2003. And that infrastructure deficit had been built, had been left by the previous government. We've been climbing out of that hole. Mr. Speaker, we're going to keep climbing, and we're going to make those investments for the future.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. More and more studies show that experts are figuring out what families have been telling us for some time, Speaker. Families feel like they're being squeezed right out of the middle class. An internal federal government document says that the middle class is being, quote, hollowed out. Given all that, is the Premier ready to back away from her plan to hit households with
new— Member from Eglinton Lawrence, come to order. Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. So, same question, different party.
Yeah.
It's surprising coming from the NDP, Mr. Speaker, that there isn't a question about how they would build transit and how we would work together as a collective, Mr. Speaker, all of us, to make sure that the investments are made for the future. But nonetheless, I understand that people in the middle class, that there are constraints and there are pressures on people, Mr. Speaker, and that's why we have made many of the changes that we've made. So whether it is expanding the 30% off tuition grant, Mr. Speaker, 230,000 students received that last year, and we've now expanded that to five-year programs, Mr. Speaker, securing retirement with pension reform, Mr. Speaker. You know, if there is any issue that is of concern to people across the middle class, it's what their retirement is going to look like. I'm surprised that the Leader of the Third Party isn't working with us on that, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Speaker, yesterday I asked whether the Premier agreed with her federal leader, who said this weekend, and I quote, "The middle class is already having a hard time making ends meet and struggling with debt. Tax increases for them are not in the cards and not on the table," unquote. The Premier didn't answer my question, so I'm going to ask her again. Does the Premier agree with her federal leader that middle-class families experiencing hard times shouldn't be asked to pay more?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. So, as I said yesterday, you know, we need a federal partner. It would be terrific to have a federal government that would work with us. And if we had a federal government that could work with us and that understood that having a long-term infrastructure plan, Mr. Speaker, was something that was critical, then, you know, we might be having a different discussion. We don't have a federal government that is interested in doing that. Unfortunately, I will continue to call on the federal government, but it may take a change of government, Mr. Speaker, to actually get that in place. The other, I just want to talk about some of the other things that we have. And by that,
final supplementary.
Speaker, Justin Trudeau isn't the only one concerned about middle-class families. During the Liberal leadership race, one candidate made it clear that this was the wrong way for Ontario to go. Quote, "Lots of people are calling for an adult conversation about road pricing, property tax hikes, and even regional sales taxes. Glenn Murray does not think it's the right way to go. The middle class is taxed out." Now, does the Premier agree with her Minister of Transportation? Is she actually ready to back away from her plan?
So, Mr. Speaker, I'm not ready. I'm not going to back away from a plan to build transit. We have not brought forward our plan in terms of the revenue stream. So, the Leader of the Third Party and the members of the Conservative caucus who are interested in focusing on a tool and an issue within a broader discussion, fine, that's their prerogative. But the fact is we have not brought forward our plan. But will I back away from building transit? I will not. And quite frankly, Mr. Speaker, I think that the members for Parkdale High Park, the member for Bramley, Gormalton, Davenport, Beaches, East York, Hamilton Mountain, Hamilton East, Stony Creek, Toronto, Danforth, Trinity, Spadina, all of whom said, "I pledge to support new ways to raise funds for a better transportation network in the GTHA," Mr. Speaker. They don't want to back away from building transit either. So I stand with those members, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, Leader. You see it, please. You see it, please. Order. Order. New question. Leader of the Third Party.
Speaker, my next question is also for the Premier. The Premier can argue that Justin Trudeau's views don't apply to Ontario. She can claim that the views of the Minister of Transportation are irrelevant, but I want to ask her about her own party as well. The 2011 Liberal platform specifically and clearly ruled out new taxes. Page 53 of the Liberal platform says they will keep their promises, quote, without resorting to higher taxes. Does the Premier agree with the promises she made to the people of Ontario when she was elected?
So, Mr. Speaker, as I have said, we are committed to continuing to build transit. I have not said what the plan will be. We are going to bring the plan forward in our budget, Mr. Speaker. There are a number of suggestions that have been made about how to put in place a revenue stream to build transit. We are going to bring forward a plan to do that, Mr. Speaker. And in case the member opposite had not noticed, Mr. Speaker, I've only been the Premier for the last year, Mr. Speaker. This is a new government, new Premier, and we are putting our plan in place. And, Mr. Speaker, I would expect that the leader—
Carry on, please.
I would expect, Mr. Speaker, that the Leader of the Third Party would support, at least in principle, the notion of building new transit and having the money to pay for that transit, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, our economy is made up of people, and if they're not doing well, our economy will not do well and will not prosper. The Premier seems determined to move ahead with her plan to hit families with new costs that will make life more expensive for them. And she doesn't seem to care that everyone from her Minister of Transportation to her federal leader agrees. Or disagrees actually with her and agrees with us. Now, is this Premier finally ready to back away from this wrong-headed move?
Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I completely agree with the leader of the third party that if people are not doing well, then the economy is not doing well. If people can't get to work, Mr. Speaker, if businesses can't move their goods around and can't expand, then they can't create the jobs that the people need, Mr. Speaker. So we're going to continue to support people. We're going to support them in the ways that we have. We are going to continue with the tuition off the reduction on tuition, Mr. Speaker. We're going to continue on the Ontario Clean Energy Benefit, Mr. Speaker. We're going to continue to modernize the child care system, Mr. Speaker. We're going to continue to put the Ontario Child Benefit in people's hands, Mr. Speaker. Those are all very important issues. And we are going to invest in infrastructure and in transit, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that in the future, in the immediate future, that there are jobs, Mr. Speaker, and in the longer-term future, that we have the economic growth that we need for the people in this province.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, adding new taxes, tolls, and fees will make life more expensive for families, and they're already struggling with the highest hydro bills and auto insurance rates in the entire country. Yesterday, the Premier said she's, and I quote, very cognizant of the burdens that middle-class people are feeling. Well, if that's the case, Speaker, I don't understand why she doesn't feel that she has an obligation to listen to Ontario families, to listen to her federal leader, to listen to her transportation minister, and back away from her plan to put more taxes, tolls, and fees on the backs of those families.
Thank you, Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I have spent a lot of time listening to people, Mr. Speaker. I have traveled the entire province in the last year, and I have spoken to people in every part of this province, in every corner of the province. And I agree with the member opposite that people are feeling stretched, they are feeling pushed, and they want a certain economic future. They want to know that there's some stability. They want to know that jobs are going to be there. So it's our responsibility as government to make sure that we address the issues that may be holding the economy back. Mr. Speaker, infrastructure is one of those. So while we work to put more money in people's hands, by reducing auto insurance, Mr. Speaker, that is happening, by reducing electricity prices, by making sure that young people have access to, that people have access to post-secondary, Mr. Speaker, while we do those things, we also have to invest in the infrastructure that will allow the economy to thrive.
Member from Chatham, come to order. The question, the member from Cambridge.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the government House Leader. The House Leader still has an opportunity to walk away from his job-killing gas tax, and business leaders in his riding are telling us loud and clear that this government has the wrong priorities. He should also find it troubling that in an article published on April 5th in the Waterloo Region Record, the Premier said that there are no guarantees Kitchener and Waterloo will get to use any new money to fund transit projects for the region. Now, the government's lone wolf from a region where a Liberal MPP qualifies as an endangered species, I would think he would attempt to put his constituents' interests first. But to my amazement, Mr. Speaker, the government House Leader said, and I quote, "We need to have a conversation about what's going to work for Toronto and Hamilton first." Whoa. Will the government House Leader stand up for his constituents and say no to the job-killing gas tax, or will he continue to toe the party line at their expense?
Pick number two.
Forgive me, I'm going to provide the member with an opportunity to either rephrase his question or redirect it, because it has to be to his portfolio, which is the government, not the government House Leader. Under the circumstances, as minister, he's minister responsible for government services. So I would ask you to decide how to either
Excuse me. Order.
I would ask the member to either redirect the question to the appropriate minister or to rephrase the question so that it fits into his portfolio. So you have that choice, please.
Mr. Speaker, I'll direct that question to the Premier.
Thank you. Premier.
transportation and infrastructure.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We are making in Kitchener-Waterloo the biggest transportation and transit investments in the history of this province, Mr. Speaker. We are working with Chair Seeley, with the member from Kitchener Centre, to build the most amazing rapid transit line. We are now buying up and building track to get two-way GO service. And what is his party doing? We put four GO trains in and the Tories take four VIA trains away. Your party has just overseen the biggest reduction in rail service to Kitchener in the history of the country, and you have the nerve to ask that question? So why don't you call the federal member from your area and ask him to put the four GO trains back? Then we'd actually have eight.
Thank you.
Four VIA trains back. So you can
see it, please. You see it, please. You see it, please.
Thank you. Member. Supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I want to know who's in charge over there. The Transportation Minister says that there's going to be money to be used for transit in the area. The Premier went and said, made no commitment that gas tax revenue would be used for our transit area. You know, I want to know, Mr. Speaker, if the people of Kitchener Centre and Waterloo Region will stand up for this Toronto First strategy at the expense of residents of Waterloo Region. It's a simple fact, which the government does not seem to understand. When the cost of doing business goes up, jobs go down. Failed green energy policies have driven the cost of doing business up, and the gas tax threatens to do the same thing, Mr. Speaker. The Ontario Trucking Association and the Greater Kitchener-Waterloo Chamber of Commerce both agree that a 10-cent gas tax, road tolls, and other misguided revenue tools will lead to more job losses. Mr. Speaker, will they finally stand up for residents in Waterloo Region and say yes to jobs and no to more taxes?
You see it, please. You see it, please.
Thank you. Minister?
Thanks. Mr. Speaker, I'm curious. I'm still waiting for the answer from the member. There were four VIA trains, Mr. Speaker, four VIA trains. We added four GO trains. Now, I know his math isn't very good, but I think even the PhD could figure out that's eight. Mr. Speaker, four, the Tories put four away. We're back to four. We have something called Highway 7, Mr. Speaker. Sir.
It seems that I can't get order until I actually stop everything going on. Stop the clock, please. The member from Oxford, the member from Halton, and the member from Cambridge who asked the questions, come to order. Carry on.
The other thing we're doing with the member from Kitchener Centre, Mr. Speaker, is we are assembling land and building Highway 7, which is really critically important. So, GO service, LRT service, and Highway 7. That sounds like the best deal people in Kitchener have had in several generations, Mr. Speaker. And why is that happening,
Mr. Answer.
Speaker? Because we are spending 2% of the province's GDP on infrastructure. They spent 0.25%. But, Mr. Speaker, I want to conclude by commending Mr. Flaherty and the Tories.
Thank you.
They are federally. They're consistent federally. They're spending 0.25%.
Thank you. New question. The member from Kitchener-Waterloo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. During the economic downturn, Sarnia lost more than 7% of their workforce, and it still hasn't recovered. There are families in Sarnia that used to rely on a paycheck from Ethel and Coruno, Dow, or the UBE parts plant. But those jobs have left, and 5,000 jobs that used to be in Sarnia before the recession haven't returned. Does the Premier think that the Liberal status quo is working for communities like Sarnia?
Premier.
Trade and Employment.
The Minister of Economic Development, Employment.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And Mr. Speaker, I'm proud and happy to say that there are 8,000 more people working in the Sarnia area than there were a year ago today, Mr. Speaker. And in fact, when you think And this is an area, there's no question that this is an area that has been challenged by the recession and the change in manufacturing. It's an incredibly important part of this province. I met, in fact, just yesterday with members, local leadership from Lambton County, talking about the chemical sector. I know there are many people in Sarnia and the Sarnia area that are employed in that important sector. But most importantly, in terms of indicators, Mr. Speaker, the unemployment rate in January of 2013 was 9%. In January of this year, it is down to 6.9%, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, supplementary.
Thank you. Thank you again. Again to the through the Premier. The Liberal government claimed the HST would create 600,000 jobs, which we have yet to see. They claim no string-detached giveaways would create jobs, but in southwestern Ontario, anyone can see that that plan isn't working. According to Sarnia-Lambton Workplace Development Board, unemployment in their community is 8%. In Guelph, it's 7%. In London, it's 8%. And in Niagara, it's a whopping 9%. Clearly, the status quo isn't working. Ontario needs a smarter plan. Will the Premier admit that this province needs a targeted plan that rewards job creators, gets hydro rates under control, and provides some relief for small businesses? Or is she going to stick with
Member
the
from Eglinton Lawrence, come to order. Minister.
Well, thank you again, Mr. Speaker. And the facts show, Mr. Speaker, from StatsCan Canada, there are 8,000 more people working in Windsor, Sarnia than were a year ago today. The unemployment rate has dropped down to 6.9%, Mr. Speaker, and this is proof that our jobs plan is working. And certainly the discussions that I had yesterday with members who are concerned about the chemical sector, which is one of the sectors that's extremely important in that entire area, they were very positive about the outlook, Mr. Speaker. They appreciate the efforts that the province is making to partner with them to make sure that the progress that we're beginning to see continues. And it's progress that we're seeing right around this province with almost 450,000 jobs created since the bottom of the recession, 80% of those jobs in the private sector. We added 7,800 youth jobs last month alone in this province. We're seeing the progress. We're seeing the importance of our jobs plan, Mr. Speaker.
New question, the member from Oakville.
Thank you, Speaker. I've got a question this morning from the Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment. Ontario's agri-food sector is a very strong driver for the Ontario economy and is one of the priorities of this government. However, it's also an industry that's had its challenges of late, especially in the Leamington and the Essex County area. Speaker, there's been a number of stories recently, today as well, in the news, stating that a company may be looking to move its business into the Heinz facility. Now, I know our government's been very, very active in this area, but today, Speaker, through you to the minister, would he please provide this House with an update on what our government has been doing to assist the community of Leamington.
Thank you. The Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the question from the member from Oakville. And although I can't talk about the specifics, the reference to the articles in the media that are that have appeared today, but I can say, Mr. Speaker, that since day one, I and many members of the government, including, of course, the Premier, have been working very collaboratively with the local leadership, the business and political leadership in Leamington and the Leamington area, as well as representatives of the employees that were affected by the Heinz closure. And I want to say that the Mayor of Leamington has been very proactive on this as well. I spoke with him last week. Of course, the Windsor-Essex Economic Development Corporation, led by Sandra Pupatello, has been very involved. And I say, most importantly as well, Teresa Perusa, the member, the MPP from Windsor West, has been very active working with the company and prospective investors to bring jobs to this important part of the province.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Through you, back to the Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment. I'm sure we're all pleased to hear about that ongoing support that the government's provided in the Leamington area. Now, Leamington, like the region of Chatham-Kent-Essex, is the hub of Ontario's agri-food sector. I'm sure that all the workers and the growers in that area are going to be pleased to hear that efforts are being made, they're ongoing, to ensure economic growth in the area and to make sure that growth continues. But, Speaker, today, through you, can the minister update the House on any concrete and specific examples of the work our government is doing to attract new business to this wonderful area?
Thank you. Minister.
Well, again, Mr. Speaker, it's our role as government to do everything we can to support this community as they move through this challenging time. And I have to say that I've been deeply involved right since day one in doing what I can to make sure that investment and jobs comes to this community. We're working closely with Heinz and with potential investors, working with them about the Heinz plans for their plant, so we can work with the community to move forward. And, of course, late last last fall, we provided funds through our Communities in Transition Fund as well to support the workers that were affected and will be affected by the layoffs. But, Mr. Speaker, I'm optimistic that we're going to find a solution that's going to bring new, good, high-paying, sustainable jobs to the Leamington and Leamington area. And it's really, quite frankly, Mr. Speaker, it's due to the hard work of so many great, dedicated individuals
Answer.
In the business community, through the development corporations in the Windsor-Essex area, the mayor and his staff in Leamington, and the government officials
Thank you.
Working hard on this.
New question, the member from
My question this morning is for the Deputy Premier. In the past 12 months, Ontario has lost 30,000 vital manufacturing jobs. You will know that London, and specifically your riding of London North Centre, and all of southwestern Ontario.
I get a sense that, and I'll listen carefully to this, but I'm getting a sense that there seems to be a theme where you're going after somebody in a riding. That's not appropriate. Make sure you ask your question to the person that his portfolio is responsible for the question.
Okay. Mr. Speaker, then this is for the Premier. In the past 12 months since you become the Premier, we've lost 30,000 vital manufacturing jobs. You will know that London and all of southwestern Ontario has lost a number of companies, Invacare, Kellogg's, Tender Tootsies, Worthington Cylinders, Westcast Industries, Imperial Oil Lubricants, and Ethel Corporation. Premier, these job losses are occurring across southwestern Ontario, so why is your government persisting with your half-baked idea to raise gas taxes 10 cents a litre to pay for Toronto's transit?
Question.
Premier, with thousands and thousands of jobs being lost in London, do you think now is the time for a $2.6 billion tax grab?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I know that the Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment is going to want to speak to the job creation that has gone on in the Southwest. But I just want to once again, Mr. Speaker, say there have not been decisions made about a revenue stream, Mr. Speaker, and what tools would be used or what tools would not be used. And I just want to be very clear about that. We're very sensitive to whatever we do to have a revenue stream in place to build infrastructure, Mr. Speaker, that it be fair, that it be dealt with in a way that is sensitive to how people are struggling in their day-to-day lives, Mr. Speaker, and that by region, that the money that's raised in one region is used to build the infrastructure in that region, Mr. Speaker. So the attempts to cloud the waters, Mr. Speaker, on this issue, when what we're talking about
Answer.
Is continuing to invest in infrastructure across the province, I think are really irresponsible.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, back.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, back to the Premier. Of course, Premier, you are from Toronto, so it's no wonder you are calling for all of Ontario to pay a share in the costs for public transportation in downtown Toronto. And
order. Finish, please.
And Premier, despite all their talk, the leader of the NDP refuses to hold your government to account and actually continues to support your each and every move. Premier, here's a nice and easy one for you. In January, London's unemployment climbed higher once again as 3,300 more London residents lost their jobs. With so many London residents currently out of work, do you think it's right to force the City of London drivers to pay for Toronto's transit that most will never use?
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, the member opposite knows perfectly well that that is not something we have ever supported. It's not what we're talking about. We're talking about investing in transit across the province, Mr. Speaker. So whatever the revenue stream is and however we decide in our plan to put in place that revenue stream, we will do it in a fair way, Mr. Speaker. But I want to be clear that the way I do politics, the way we do politics, Mr. Speaker, is that we believe that government has to work for the whole province. The extension of his question, Mr. Speaker, is that somehow we come here with a narrow view of our responsibility and we only look to our own riding and we only think about the people that we directly represent. Well, that may be the way he does politics, Mr. Speaker. That may be the way their party does politics.
mention the same thing once again, and that is that we have members that are provoking other members while the question and answers are being put, and I'm not that's not helpful to this debate in this House, and I'm going to ask you and remind the government side again, there are members who are using members' names on that side. I don't like it. It's got to stop. It elevates the temperature that it shouldn't be. So let's bring it down. New question, the member from Hamilton Mountain.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Yesterday, the minister defended the closure of the acquired brain injury clinic at McMaster's Children's Hospital. If the minister had bothered to talk to the pediatric ABI experts, she would know the importance of the clinic's cutting-edge, coordinated, and integrated approach. Dr. Robert Hollenberg, a highly regarded pediatric neurosurgeon who co-founded the ABI clinic, wrote to me. He said, and I quote, "An archaic model not supported by any research or accepted best practice guidelines," end quote. He further reported that the clinic had been praised by colleagues across Ontario and that similar programs are now being funded in Ottawa and Toronto. Will the minister explain why she didn't do her homework?
Minister of Long-Term Care.
Well, Speaker, I can assure the member opposite that what I said yesterday is absolutely true. Children will still receive care for brain injuries at McMaster Children's Hospital. Speaker, instead of having to wait for 2 weeks for an appointment, because that clinic only operated one day every 2 weeks, they will be able to get the care they need in a more timely way, Speaker. We are transforming health care. When services can be provided in the community instead of in the hospital, then that is often more appropriate care. Sometimes patients need care in hospital, and they'll get that care. They'll get that care quickly. If services can be provided in the community, then they should receive those services in the community. This is a reorganization, but I can assure you that children who need the care because of an acquired brain injury will receive that care.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, the clinic population has quadrupled in the last few years as a result of developing awareness of the prevalence of ABI and its potentially life-altering effects on young people. But now, following the acute stage, no comprehensive or multidisciplinary care will be available to these young people. Dr. Hollenberg says, and I quote, "This will not only overwhelm already busy primary care pediatricians and family physicians in the community, but it will also frustrate and dismay the majority of the ABI population who truly need a comprehensive, multidisciplinary follow-up clinic staffed by professionals," end quote. Is the minister going to continue to justify this cut, or will she finally do something about it?
Question. Thank you. Minister.
Well, Speaker, our commitment to people with acquired brain injuries, I think, speaks for itself. We have almost doubled our funding for services for people with acquired brain injuries. We're spending an additional $36 million on people with acquired brain injuries. And we've also more than doubled supportive housing supports for people with acquired brain injuries. Speaker, this is often a lifelong disability, and it's really important to get people back into the community, living as full and normal and productive life as they possibly can. And that happens when they're in supportive housing, Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Ottawa Orleans.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Natural Resources. In Ontario, we are fortunate to have a wealth of biodiversity. This biodiversity, along with our natural heritage, are severely threatened by invasive species. As well, invasive species can cost the Ontario economy tens of millions of dollars. Once established, invasive species can be extremely difficult and costly to control and remediate. For example, the negative impact of invasive zebra mussels is estimated to cost $75 to $91 million a year. And that's just one species. I have read about Asian carp, and I have attended meetings in Chicago on Asian carp, and I'm very concerned about their spread in Ontario's Great Lakes. These fish can grow to 100 pounds and are a threat to our $2.2 billion recreational fishing industry and the commercial fishery. As well, every year, invasive plants cost the agriculture and forest industries in Canada about $7.3 billion. I know that stopping the spread of invasive species is a priority for your ministry, and I'm happy.
Thank you. Question? Answer? Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Speaker. And I want to thank the hardworking member. He's got more to add, obviously, the member from Ottawa-Orleans, for this very important question. Indeed, this legislation has broad support from many stakeholders, many of whom are here today with us. And I appreciate the opportunity to inform members about this legislation, about what our government is proposing. If passed, Ontario would become the first and only jurisdiction with standalone legislation in Canada. This is landmark legislation, Speaker, that would help by providing the powers to intervene earlier, leading to significantly reduced environmental and economic costs for Ontarians. The new legislation would provide a stronger legislative framework with which to prevent, detect, control, and manage invasive species that impact our natural environment, by including prohibitions on activities such as possessing and transporting invasives, enabling rapid response, and ensuring modernized inspections. Speaker, this is a risk-based approach that considers a full range of costs, the environment, and the economy.
Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Speaker, and thank you, Minister, for letting us know about this important legislation. As I previously mentioned, invasive species are causing significant damage to the natural environment, and managing invasive species in Ontario is a complex and challenging task. I've heard from many of my constituents in Ottawa-Orleans about the damaging effects of the emerald ash borer. This insect is a serious threat to ash trees across Ontario. The beetle kills approximately 99% of the ash trees as it moves through an area and has infested many trees in my riding and across the whole city. I'm glad that your ministry has taken action on invasive species such as the emerald ash borer. I understand this proposed legislation will provide many tools to address these challenges in Ontario. Speaker, could the minister please tell the members of this House and what other steps our government has taken to stop the spread of invasive species?
Thank you.
Minister. Thank you, Speaker. And again, appreciate the question from the member from Ottawa-Orleans. And I'm pleased to have the opportunity to outline the important measures we are taking to combat the spread of invasive species. In 2011, our ministry established an invasive species research centre, the first of its kind in the province of Sault Ste. Marie, to help combat invasive species. We provided nearly $10 million toward the establishment and operation of this centre in partnership with the federal government. The Invasive Species Centre would support the proposed legislation by working with our partners to help deliver research and technology that can help us better understand invasive species and develop the options to combat them, to also develop education and outreach programs to help Ontarians be more aware of the risks of invasive species and the part they can play in helping to defend our province. In the province of BC, Speaker, the mountain pine beetle has cost the BC government $917 million. These are effects that we certainly do not want to see in this province, so we're going to work very hard to ensure that we do everything we can to combat invasive species in Ontario.
New question. The member from Barrie.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Premier, the current Liberal MPP from Niagara Falls demonstrated yesterday that he fully supports the government's agenda to introduce a provincial gas tax to fund GTA transit. And this extra 10 cents per litre for gas is going to bankrupt families and businesses already struggling to keep up with rising costs. Today, it costs over $1.32 for gas. As of January, Niagara has one of the highest unemployment rates in this province. This government has failed Niagara. Their new MP has failed Niagara yesterday by propping up this government. Premier, why should the residents of Niagara pay for you to ride the subway?
They voted for change.
Premier.
Minister of Finance.
Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, I hear a lot of nonsense today and for the last week in this House about what is happening and what is actually occurring. So let me say this, Mr. Speaker. There's over 200 pages in the last budget and economic update. Nowhere does it call for what they've just suggested. If they read what's here, this is what they'll learn. They'll learn that we have cut personal income tax by $355 per average family. We have actually cut $8 billion in tax relief for businesses. We've cut the small business tax from 5.5% to 4.5%. And we're helping more businesses grow as a result of the stimuluses that we've been putting in. The individuals across the way here, all they want to do is take away on the one hand, and the other ones want to just give it away. We have to take a balanced approach, Mr. Speaker. We cannot take extreme points of view in order to grow our economy, and that is exactly what we'll do.
Supplementary?
Hawkins. I'll tell you what's extreme is continue to tax the Ontario people to the point where they can't afford the rent anymore.
Here,
the truth is, gas tax, trades tax, liberal health care premium tax, remember
tax,
that
tax,
one?
Tax, fee,
are just
fee.
Euphemisms for liberal scandal tax. The problem is this government's affinity for scandals. And the solution is not gouge the taxpayer. You'd have enough money for transit if your weak ministers didn't blow millions on Orange, e-health, gas plants, Pan Am games. The latest tax will cost an extra $5 every time you fill up your tank. Stop the taxes. Stop the overspending.
It's gonna kill business.
Stop the scandals.
Enough is
Ontario
enough.
Deserves a
kill
responsible
jobs.
Government just as much as Niagara deserves responsible representation. Instead,
they
Premier, do you think
change.
It could use the money from your next inevitable scandal to fund GTA Transit instead
Answer.
Of dipping into all our pockets
Question.
Again?
Minister.
So, Mr. Speaker, we'll continue to work on behalf of the good of Ontario, including all the infrastructure projects that we've been doing in Barrie.
Yeah.
And that individual across the way has not supported these very initiatives that are for the benefit of our competitiveness for the future. In fact, the members opposite like to quote a very prominent economist, and this is what he had to say about their plan. It's extremely unlikely to produce any jobs.
Woo!
A few calculations should have made that evident, said Don Drummond.
Don.
This is what somebody else had to say about their job-killing plan. Ontario PC leader Tim Hudak's latest economic offering is simplistic, headline-hunting plan that's more concerned with austerity than job creation, and it ignores many of the most important drivers of economic growth. And that was said by Michael Warren, Mr. Speaker, on January 14th. Better still, this is what an individual
Answer.
Had to say about the Ontario Liberal plan. He said this: things are looking much better in Ontario than they were, and the Ontario economy
Thank
is starting
you.
To grow again, courtesy
Thank
of
you.
Jim Flynn.
Okay. New question. The member from Niagara Falls.
Yeah, Mr. Speaker, I'd like, just like to remind the my colleague that I beat the.
Stop the clock, please. Stop the clock. As a learning moment, identify who you have the question for. Leave that for another time. Carry on.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Local schools are the heart of communities. Concerned parents from Niagara-on-the-Lake made passionate and informative presentations last night to keep their local school, Parliament Public School, open. Parents in Niagara-on-the-Lake, the Chamber of Commerce, the Lord Mayor, Dave Eek, and Council are all working to ensure that Parliament Oak Public School does not close its doors. This school sits on a historic site where the Act Against Slavery was signed in 1793. Will the Premier listen to local voices and assure that Parliament Oak Public School stays open?
Finger.
Minister of Education.
Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you very much, and I want to congratulate the member for his recent election. And I think it would be useful to review the process around how school closures work. And I think we do have to acknowledge that one of the problems that we do have in Ontario today is that the birth rate has gone down. I'm sorry, I can't do anything about that as Minister of Education. And the reality is that we have yes, the member from Cambridge is working on it, but the reality is that we do have in many communities more seats in our schools than we actually have children or are ever likely to have. But it's actually local school
Answer.
Boards that are charged with addressing this particular issue of trying to figure out what schools need to stay open and where there are too many schools. And we can talk about that process.
Yes, we will. It's supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, students at Parliament Oak scored well above the provincial average for literacy and math. The school has attracted new families to Niagara-on-the-Lake. The Accommodation Review Committee recommends the school stays open. $1.6 million has been invested in renovating Parliament Oak since 2009. I was with the parents in Niagara-on-the-Lake, and so was the Premier. Parents know that Parliament Oak Public School should be a model for schools for the Niagara region and the entire province. Will the Premier assure parents, families, and the community in Niagara and Lake that Parliament Oak Public School will not close?
Minister.
Well, as I was saying, Speaker, this is actually a question for your local school board, because in fact, under Ontario's Education Act, it is actually the local school board that is charged with making the decision around what schools will be open, what schools will be closed, where the students will attend, and managing the whole issue around do we have enough schools. Certainly, if you want to intervene on behalf of your community, you can make an intervention with the local school board. But it is the trustees who are locally elected who are responsible for the accommodation review process, which you describe, which is ongoing. Thank you.
Thank you. A question, the member from Scarborough Cooksville. Mrs. Zaghi's Cooksville.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Education. Speaker, as you know, today is Pink Shirt Day, and it all started when a grade 9 student in Nova Scotia, a boy, went to school wearing a pink shirt, and he was mercilessly bullied for looking gay. Two-thirds of kids who identify as gay, lesbian, bisexual, or transgendered feel unsafe at school. Almost three-quarters of kids report hearing homosexual slurs at school every day. Minister, bullying in our schools and in our society is a real problem, with devastating results. I know that this is an issue that all members of this House feel strongly about. So would the minister please tell us what she's doing to fight bullying in our schools? Thank you.
Thank you, Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you, Speaker, and I thank the member for the question. And I'm delighted to be able to speak about this issue because it's very important to me, and I think important to members from all three parties. Two high school students, David Shepherd and Travis Price, didn't stand by while that grade 9 student in Nova Scotia was bullied for wearing pink. They went out and they bought pink shirts too and took a brave stand against bullying. I'm proud to be a member of this legislature, which passed aggressive anti-bullying legislation, and I'm proud to see so many members from all parties wearing pink today in honour of those Nova Scotia students and showing their support for our anti-bullying initiative.
Answer.
And knowing that we all stand united when it comes to protecting our kids from bullying.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Minister. Those two grade 12 boys encouraged their classmates to wear pink too. They went home that night and emailed their friends, and word spread. What they essentially did was they changed the culture at their school. And that is what, Mr. Speaker, we need to do, not just in our schools, but in society at large. So would the minister tell us what we are doing outside of our schools to help counter bullying?
Minister.
The member is absolutely correct, and as a government, we took actually a precedential action for Canada. For the first time in Ontario and Canada, we recognized cyberbullying in our Accepting Schools Act, and in fact, we included cyberbullying as part of the definition of bullying. That means that in Ontario schools, if a principal believes that actions occurred online have a negative impact on the school climate, the principal has the authority to take action, Speaker. But that's not all we're doing. We've provided bullying prevention training for up to 25,000 teachers now and close to 7,500 principals and vice principals. We work with Kids Help Phone to provide a bullying prevention hotline 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And we're bringing together experts to advise on the best possible way to make sure that we continue with bullying prevention programs all across our school to keep our kids safe.
Thank you.
In their learning environment.
Question, the member from Eldon, Middlesex, London.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Minister, back in June, I asked your ministry to give me a breakdown of the capital costs for the St. Joseph's Forensic Mental Health Care Centre in St. Thomas. After a dizzying array of emails going back and forth between the Minister of Health and Minister of Infrastructure, I could not get a straight answer. Today, we learned that you shortchanged the hospital on $3.9 million in annual operating costs and only authorized the money at the last minute. This financial mismanagement is unsettling, but it's what we've come to expect from this government.
Yep.
Minister, what other financial oversights have you made with this facility?
Thank you. Minister, Health, Long-Term Care.
Speaker, I am very, very happy that the member opposite has asked me this question. As any member who has had a hospital built in their riding, and there are many of us who have had a new hospital built in their riding, they will know that sometimes hospitals are built for future expansion. And we have something called the post-construction operating program that ramps up operating money as the hospital actually increases their capacity. This is the normal business of new hospitals opening. Applies as well to the hospital in St. Thomas. I was very pleased that we were able to follow through on that commitment. We are not shortchanging any hospital, anything. This is an additional $3.9 million in funding so more people can be cared for in that wonderful new facility.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Back to the Minister. Minister, this government has squandered billions on moving gas plants, billions in the Orange fiasco, and we're not even close to uncovering how much the Pan Am Games is going to cost us. You yourself has presided over more scandals than any other minister. Your ministry couldn't give me a dollar amount for the capital costs, and apparently still can't, for the hospital that you built in St. Thomas, and you only authorized the $3.9 million in annual operating costs at the last minute after receiving a call from the London Free Press. For a minister with so many scandals under her belt and who is making major financial decisions on an ad hoc basis, I'm concerned you pose a risk to worthwhile projects like the St. Joseph's Mental Health Forensics Care Center. Minister, what other financial irregularities are you responsible for?
Minister.
Speaker, I think this is this member's way of saying thank you for building not just one new hospital, but two new hospitals in his riding. So I am very pleased to say you're welcome, and I'm glad the people in the St. Thomas area are getting access to better care. You will know that the previous capacity of the old facility was 80 beds. The new building was built with expanded capacity for 89. And over time, as we always do, Speaker, we will be ramping up funding. This was very much a normal part of business, and I was very happy to confirm that we are expanding to ramp up a capacity at the hospital as it gets up and running.
Thank you. New question. Member from Beaches East York.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And thank you. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Labour. It has been more than 3 years since I introduced my private member's bill to protect employees' tips. Bill 49, as amended by committee following second reading, is still languishing somewhere on a Liberal list. Meanwhile, thousands of hardworking Ontarians continue to wait for the protection which you yourself promised them. Will this bill be called for third reading by this government?
Thank you. Minister of Labour.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and I thank the member for the question. And I think the member opposite knows that we have worked very closely together on this very important bill. I've spoken in support of the bill, and in fact we have worked quite in a collaborative way in making sure that all the necessary amendments that needs to be made to the bill in the committee get made. And I want to thank the member for the hard work and the collaboration on that bill. Whether when this bill comes for a third reading, as the Speaker, you know, and the member opposite know, that's not a decision that I, as the Minister of Labour, responsible for. That is up to the three House leaders to decide what matter comes to the floor of this House, and I will leave it in their good, wise wisdom.
Answer.
I support the bill, and I urge all three House leaders to bring that bill to the floor of the House. Thank you very much.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, with all due respect, it is up to the Liberal government to call the bills that they say they support. The minister has repeatedly expressed his support for this bill, and he's done so again today. his party has made amendments to make the bill even more palatable to them. The bill, all of the amendments that were made during committee were made by the Liberal Party. Workers across the province have waited long enough. If the bill is passed today, they will still have to wait until August the 26th to finally stop some of their bosses from stealing their tips. When will this government call this bill?
Thank you very much again, Speaker. Speaker, I want to say again, thank the member. We work shoulder to shoulder on this very important bill, and I have spoken in support of it, and we have made some necessary amendments. And again, it's up to the three House leaders to decide when they're going to bring a matter forward to the floor of this House, and not I as a member. But, Speaker, I do want to talk about one important issue. I wish that that member from the NDP should have shown the same kind of passion for minimum wage as well, because when it comes to issues like minimum wage, he and his party has been absolutely silent. For over a year, Speaker, we've been working on the issue for minimum wage, and I did not hear from that member who claimed to speak on behalf of vulnerable workers to talk about the issue of minimum wage, that we should increase minimum wage, that we should index it to the cost of living. And I hope that this member will speak to his leader and his caucus and support Bill 165, the Fair Minimum Wage Act.
Thank you. Before I entertain a few more points of order that I know are coming, I would like to introduce in the Speaker's gallery today the Ontario Council of Universities Research Group, who are here to observe. We welcome you and thank you for being here in the gallery. The member from Parkdale High Park on a point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Because it is the day to wear pink, I would like to move a unanimous consent motion that all parties this afternoon could have up to 5 minutes to speak about the importance of this important day. Thank you.
I have to do the unanimous consent first. The member from Parkdale High Park is seeking unanimous consent to this afternoon speak up to 5 minutes on a pink day or bullying. Do we agree?
Agreed.
Agreed. The member from Nepean Carleton on a point of order.
I appreciate the comments by my colleague from the third party. I'm just rising to say that the Ontario PC Party also wanted to seek unanimous consent for the same 5 minutes, so I'm pleased that that... We had talked.
No. I have to hear this, please. So can you please explain in more in-depth?
We spoke beforehand. I appreciated the comments by the Minister of Education, as well as the comments from the MPP from Mississauga-Streetsville. But we did obviously want to have our opportunity to speak, and our education critic will address that. Thank you.
We don't need then a unanimous consent, and therefore that'll be taken care of. And I'm going to have to direct this because this afternoon is very broad, and I'll ask the. I suspect we're going to be doing this following members' statements. So, having said that, it would be the normal. So, the Government House Leader on the same.
Yeah, Mr. Speaker, I was simply going to say perhaps we could leave it up to the House Leaders to speak to determine when it happens. You've suggested after members' statements, so I'll confer with the fellow.
I thank you, and I'll leave that to the House Leaders to determine that particular issue for this afternoon. The Premier on a point of order.
Mr. Speaker, I wanted to correct my record. I noted that the Queensway Carleton Hospital is located in the riding of the member for Nepean Carleton. In fact, it is not. She lives in the riding where the hospital is located, and the hospital serves her riding.
The member from Prince Edward Hastings on a point of order.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. It's a pleasure to welcome a couple of local politicians to the legislature today. Dan McCaw is the Reeve of Wollaston Township, and Graham Blair is the Deputy Reeve of Wollaston Township from beautiful Coe Hill in North Hastings. Welcome to the legislature, gentlemen.
The Minister of Finance on the point of order.
Mr. Speaker, I just would like to take the opportunity to welcome Asma Mahmood, a strong community advocate in Mississauga and a champion of the arts, and she's visiting Queen's Park today. Thank you.
Okay, I'm taking a chance by standing and not dismissing the place, but I'm going to remind you once more, please, if you know that they're coming and they're not here during introductions under the both opportunities were provided, say their names during that time anyway when you know they're coming later. it's just the way we've decided it's going to work, and it's just going to make it more difficult for us when we continue to do this. So I'm going to say that there are no deferred votes, so this House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon. And no heckling, no drive-by heckling. Order.